Let us now give the definition of a distorted expectation. So we start from a distortion function g, and then the distorted expectation of a random variable x is denoted by this rho g of x, and is given by the difference of two integrals, where this f bar here is a tail function. So note that we assume that both integrals are finite. So remember that g is a function that goes from 0, 1 to 0, 1, which means that g f bar x of x, yeah, so the distortion function applied to the tail function, it's always smaller than 1 and bigger than 0, which means that this is positive and this thing here is also positive. So these integrals are also positive, and in the most general situation, these integrals can be finite or equal to plus infinity. So assume that you write the distorted expectation as minus 1 plus 2, where 1 is equal to the first integral from minus infinity to 0, 1 minus g of x dx, and 2 is equal to the integral from 0 to plus infinity g f x of x. Yeah. Then there are different situations. So case 1, say, is 1 is equal to plus infinity and 2 is finite. In that case, the distorted expectation is equal to minus infinity. The second case, the first integral is finite, but the second integral is equal to plus infinity. In this case, the distorted expectation is equal to plus infinity. The third case, both integrals are finite, and in that case, the distorted expectation is also a finite number. And the last case, case 4, both integrals are equal to plus infinity, and then you get minus infinity plus infinity, which is not defined. So then the distorted expectation is not defined. So what we do in this definition, we say that we rule out case 1, case 2, and case 4. So for us, we are always in case 3, the distorted expectation is always a finite number. So where does this definition for distorted expectation come from? So we start with the following expression for the expected value of x. And we derived this expression already in the first chapter when we talked about stochastic dominance. So we showed that the expectation of x is given by this expression. Then on the previous slide, we defined the distorted expectation in this way. And what you see is that the distorted expectation uses the same formula as for the expectation, but instead of using the tail function of x, we now use the distorted tail function. The same in the second integral, we have the tail function here, and we then move to the distorted tail function. So the distorted expectation rho g of x is the expectation of x where we replace the tail probabilities by the distorted tail probabilities. So define the function capital G of x as 1 minus the distorted tail probabilities, and g bar of x is equal to 1 minus g of x. Then the distorted expectation of x, I can write it using the function g, it's minus the integral minus infinity 0, 1 minus the g bar function plus the second integral. It is pretty simple. I just define the function g such that this holds. However, if my function, my distortion function g is left continuous, then these distorted tail functions are non-increasing and right continuous, meaning that 1 minus this function is non-decreasing and right continuous, starts in 0 and goes to 1. So you can verify that this is true when g is left continuous, and then you automatically conclude that g is a CDF, valid CDF. So if the function g, the distortion function, is left continuous, we can define a random variable y with CDF equal to the function g. And then if you compare this expression here with this expression, you see that the distorted expectation of x is actually a regular classical expectation of a new random variable. So the distorted expectation of x is equal to the expectation of y, where y is a random variable with a CDF, which is determined by 1 minus the distorted tail function. If we take this distortion function here, then you automatically find that the distorted tail probabilities are equal to the tail probabilities itself. So it means that there is no distortion at all. Distorted tail probabilities are the same as the regular tail probabilities. And then automatically you find that the distorted expectation of x is equal to the expectation of x. So this distortion function means nothing happens. Distorted expectations are the same as regular classical expectation. If the function g is concave, then the distorted expectation is always bigger than the expectation of x, and in the convex situation is the other inequality. So you can give a proof of this statement yourself, but let me here give a graphical proof of this expression, of this inequality. Okay, so remember that the expectation of x is equal to minus a first surface, and the surface is the integral, it's 1 minus the tail function of x plus another surface from 0 to plus infinity, I integrate over the tail function. So if I make a graph here, assume that this is the tail function, so this is the function f bar of x. I have here the constant 1. Then this expectation of x, it's this integral, it corresponds with this surface, and this integral here corresponds with this surface. We saw this already in chapter 1. Let's then assume that g is concave. So then the distorted tail probabilities are always bigger than the tail probability. So it means that applying the function, the concave function g, on my tail function pushes the tail function up. So I will get this tail function. So this is the function g f bar x of x. So the distorted expectation, it's equal to an integral from minus infinity to 0, 1 minus the distorted tail functions, the distorted tail probabilities, sorry, and then an integral from 0 to plus infinity, I integrate over my distorted tail function. This integral here corresponds with the surface below the black line from 0 to plus infinity. So it's this surface here. this surface here. It's the surface in between the constant one and the black distorted tail function from minus infinity to zero. It's this area. All right. So let's now connect the two and say that this area here, so the area between the blue and the black line between minus infinity and zero, I call this 2 prime. This area here I call 2. This one here I call 1. And this area here I call 1 prime. Then the expectation of x is equal to this integral, it's the surface 1. This integral here, it's the surface 2 plus 2 prime, and I have to subtract that surface 2 plus 2 prime. The distorted expectation is also a difference between two surfaces. This first integral, it's 1 plus 1 prime, if you look at the figure. And what you subtract is this integral, it's minus 2. If I now remove this 1 prime, yeah, so it's a surface, so 1 prime, it's something positive. If I remove it, I make this smaller, so I get 1 minus 2. And now I subtract another surface, I make again my total, I make it smaller, I get 1 minus 2 minus 2 prime, and then you see that this is equal to the expectation of x. So we conclude that for a concave distortion function, the distorted expectation is always bigger than the expectation of x. The proof for a convex distortion function, it's very similar, but then you start from the blue curve and the black curve will be below the blue curve. We have that the following properties hold for a distorted expectation. For the first property, you see that if we multiply the random variable x by a, then this a comes outside the distorted expectation operator as long as the a is positive. We can also add a constant b, and also this constant b comes out of the distorted expectation operator. And if we have stochastic dominance between x and y, then the distorted expectation of x and y are also ordered in this way. Let me give a proof of the first statement, and then you can try to prove 2 and 3 yourself. Okay, so we start with the distorted expectation of a times x. So we write down the definition, it's minus the integral from zero to from minus infinity to zero, 1 minus g f bar of the random variable ax plus the other integral g f bar ax of x dx. So this is just applying the definition, but now instead of using the random variable x, I use the random variable a times x. Because I use the random variable a times x, I have this tail function of the random variable a times x in x, which is equal to the probability that the random variable a times x is bigger than x. But this is equal to x bigger than x divided by a. And here I use that a is positive. So if a is not positive, I cannot make this step. But if a is positive, I find that the tail function of ax is equal to the tail function of x in x over a. So if I now fill in this expression in my definition for the distorted expectation, I find the distorted expectation of ax is equal to from minus infinity to zero, 1 minus g f x in x over a dx plus 0 to plus infinity, g tail function of x, but now in x over a dx. Then I apply a substitution. I say y is equal to x over a, which means that dy is equal to dx divided by a. And then my distorted expectation, I apply the substitution in both integrals. I find minus a times integral 1 minus g fx y dy plus a times integral from 0 to plus infinity g fx y dy. And then you find that this is equal to a times the distorted expectation of x, and that's what you want to prove. Consider now the following distortion function. So this distortion function looks as follows. This I function here is the indicator function. It means that the function value is equal to 0 if what's in between brackets is false, it's 1 if it is true. So if you go from 0 to 1 and you have here 1 minus p, then this function is 0 here, and in 1 minus p it jumps to 1. So here it jumps to the value 1 until here. So this is the function. If we use this distortion function, the distorted expectation is this expression. We can also take this distortion function, which, if you compare it with this one here, if you compare these two, you have the same distortion functions. The only difference is that here you have a strict inequality and here you have bigger or equal. So now the distortion function, it's again a function which is first 0, then it jumps to 1. But now I have something like this. So in 1 minus p, I'm still at 0, and only after 1 minus p, I jump to 1. So here you have a left continuous distortion function, while here your distortion function is right continuous. And what is interesting here is that we have exactly the same distortion function in the first and the second case. The only difference is that you have a left continuous or a right continuous jump. But left or right continuity is important, as you can see, because you start with a right continuous function, you have this plus inverse, then you have a left continuous jump, and you find the regular inverse or the quantile function of x in p. So you see, left or right continuity is important because it's essential, because the distorted expectation will change. And in the course notes, you find a generalization of these two results. So here we have two distortion functions, only one jump, but in one case left, the other case right continuous jumps. In the generalization, we say we have a distortion function with multiple jumps, but they are all either left or right continuous.